do you get a compliment?
So that your mom and dad see that you're trying to listen.
But they would think that you mean to do something great.
It pleases God and the person that told you to do it.
You might actually get to have, like, maybe something fun.
I don't know.
Then you want some stuff.
It's an amazing thing to comprehend that the God who made us, that God's longings for you and that God's longings for me are actually almost identical to our deepest longings for ourselves and for our lives and for our world. It may not seem that way because so oftentimes we focus on our smaller desires and we don't get down to the deeper longings of our hearts. But when we get down to the depth of who we are and how God's made us and our deepest longings and God's longings, they align. We've been realizing this as we've walked through this list of fruits of the Spirit found in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. This reality that God, the God of the universe, God is love. He is the God of love, and he longs for us to experience his love, for us to love him, but to love each other and to be so filled with his love that it overflows to the world around us. And when the love of God is unleashed in our lives, and when we walk in that love and you bring those two together, that bears fruit. It begins to blossom. And the world changes, and our homes change, and our schools change, and our neighborhoods change. When the love of God and the love of God in us come together and we walk in that love, it bears fruit. The same is true with joy. God is the most joyful being in all the universe. And God wants to lavish us with his joy. And in the depth of our hearts, we long for joy. And when God's joy comes and when we seek to walk in that joy and we're in partnership with God, that joy will grow. It will bear fruit. It will blossom. And that's transformational in every aspect of our lives. God is a God of kindness. And he longs for us to experience kindness and gentleness. And as Pastor Keith shared last week, we can grow in that kindness and grow in that gentleness. And again, when we partner with God, the fruit of the Spirit grows. It's not God doing it alone. It's God inviting us into partnership. And then that fruit blossoms and grows. And today, as we look at another one of the fruits of the Spirit, this one seems a little different. This isn't what we think about very often when we think about those things that our heart, our deepest longings are for. Because today we're talking about, if you didn't pick it up through all the songs we sang, we're talking about faithfulness. God is a God of radical, unyielding faithfulness. And he calls us to live and to walk in faithfulness. But we don't very often spend a normal day saying, boy, I really want to become more faithful. We should. We just don't think about it very often. We don't live in a world that talks about faithfulness almost at all anymore. But we should be talking about it. And when is it that faithfulness becomes an issue for us? When do we think about faithfulness? You know what it is usually? When someone is unfaithful. Then we realize how deeply our hearts yearn for faithfulness. When someone betrays us, when somebody's unfaithful to us, or when we are unfaithful to someone else, and we look and we go, that's not who I want to be. And so God says, I am a faithful God. And he says to us, I want you to walk in faithfulness. And when we partner, and when we are profoundly aware of God's faithfulness, when we walk in faithfulness and these come together and we partner with God, it is powerful in this world. And this world needs a new vision of faithfulness. And so we pray, oh God, that we would partner with you, that your faithfulness would be so real to us and so profound and so deep, and that we would walk in faithfulness and strive for faithfulness in your spirit and in your power, and that will bring a harvest, a blossom, the fruit of faithfulness in our lives. And may that transform our relationships and our workplaces and our schools and our homes and all that we do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bible with you, I invite you to turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 13. It's in the New Testament. The New Testament begins with four stories of the life of Jesus: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospels. It's the fourth of those Gospels. We'll have the words up on the screen as well. But I want to look at four, and if you're a note taker, you'll see in your bulletin there's a place to write these four thoughts down, so feel free to do that if you enjoy taking notes. That helps you remember what you've learned. That's great. But the first, we're going to look at some lessons of faithfulness, and here's the first lesson of faithfulness. It's Jesus' example with his disciples. If you want to see the faithfulness of God, watch Jesus with his disciples, particularly here in John chapter 13, because Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. If you want to get the purest picture of how God works in relationships, look at Jesus, because Jesus was God with us. And so here in John chapter 13, this is near the end of Jesus' life. This is happening in what we call the Last Supper. It's the last meal that Jesus is going to celebrate with his followers. He's going to institute communion in this time. And at this Last Supper, something very unique happens. Jesus gathers with the disciples. They're all around the table. And none of them have had their feet washed. In the ancient world, there was kind of a humble job that oftentimes a household servant would do, and that's they would wash the feet of people when they came in from the dusty roads and sandals, and they'd wash their feet to be refreshing and clean their feet. But they're all around the table, and nobody's feet have been cleaned. And Jesus notices this during the meal. So we pick this up in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, beginning in verse 2. The evening meal was in progress. They're already having the meal. And the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Now watch Jesus' awareness of himself. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God and he was returning to God. So, in light of knowing who he was, so he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. That was the dress of a humble servant in the ancient world. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. Do you get this picture? Here's Jesus. He is God in human flesh. He is the Lord of glory. He is the one who the Apostle Paul says in the book of Philippians, the one before whom every knee will bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. It's that Jesus. And he gets up from the table. He sees all their feet are dirty. So he gets a basin. He pours water in it. He gets a towel. And Jesus Christ, the one to whom every knee will bow, he gets on his knees one by one and washes the feet of his disciples. Now, Jesus knows what's coming. He's right before going to the cross and bearing our sins and taking our shame. He knows what's ahead of him. He also knows that every one of these 12 disciples is going to run for the hills. Every one of them is going to take off and abandon him in his deepest moment of need. They will run off and be unfaithful to him. But knowing that, one by one, he washes their feet. He gets to Thomas. He knows that Thomas will doubt him. And yet he washes Thomas's feet. The Lord of glory, God Almighty, washes the feet of Thomas. That's faithfulness. He knows that Peter is going to deny him once, twice, three times. Jesus knows that the third time that Peter denies him, that Peter is going to say, I don't know Jesus. I swear I don't know him. If I know Jesus, may I be cursed. I don't know the man. That was Peter's denial. And Jesus kneels down and he washes Peter's feet. That's faithfulness. Jesus gets to Judas, and as we read in the biblical text, it was already in the heart of Judas to betray him. And Jesus knew that. And Jesus gets at the knees of the one who will betray him and washes his feet just like he does all the others. That's faithfulness. Faithfulness is not easy. It is not simple. It is a decision. And if you want to learn about faithfulness, you look at God the Father who came in human form, Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus Christ, and you watch his faithfulness and you will learn what faithfulness looks like. If we're gonna understand faithfulness in our lives, we have to understand God's faithfulness. So here's a second lesson of faithfulness. God is faithful to protect you from temptation. He is faithful to protect you from whatever temptation comes your way. God is not the author of temptation, but he's always present protecting us from it. Why do I say that? Look at 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, to all people. You understand when you deal with temptation, you're not alone. You understand that, don't you? That's all of us. All of us face temptation. It's common to mankind. And God is, what's it say? Faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. You say, I don't feel like I can bear the temptation. Well, God's word is true, and he says, it's not beyond what you can bear. Why does he say that? But when you are tempted, he, God, will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. There is a way out to the temptation that you're facing. I don't know what temptation you're facing, but here's what I do know. There's temptations that you're facing. I know that. And I also know this. There's always a way out. Because God is faithful, and he is there at that moment. That temptation that just sort of sprouted up in your life that you have never dealt with before, but all of a sudden it's there. He's there to show you a way out. That temptation that you've fallen into every day for the last 14 years. And you say, there's no way out. God says, I am there, and there's a way out. I am faithful. I am there. There's always a way out. So God, we pause right now. I don't know each person's temptations, and it's not my business. But God, you know, and they know. And God, you know my temptations, and I know them. And we pray, oh God, that because you are faithful and you are there, we pray that we will notice and pay attention when you are showing us a way out. We pray that we will see the way out that you have given to us. Whether it's walking away, whether it's speaking a word and saying no, whether it's not walking into the circumstance, whatever it is, Lord, show us the way out. Because you are faithful and you are there. And you tell us that it's not beyond the strength that you give to us. And that you always give us a way out. Teach us how to be faithful to you as we walk away from temptation. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Lessons of faithfulness. A third lesson from God is this. God is faithful to forgive. God is always faithful to forgive. God is waiting to forgive. But we have a part in that journey of forgiveness. We need to ask for it. Listen to these words from 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. If we claim to be without sin, I've never sinned, I've never done anything wrong, I'm perfect. If we claim that, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, I recognize them, I'm sorry. If we confess our sins, he is, what does it say? Faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. He is faithful and just and he's ready to forgive. That first time when you come to the cross and confess your sins and ask Jesus to forgive you, he washes you clean, he forgives your sins, the Spirit moves in, you begin a new life, you are born again in Jesus Christ. Praise God. But what about when I stumble and fall back into sin? He's ready and waiting. What Jesus has done on the cross is enough to pay for all of our sins. So if you've received Jesus, but you've wandered back into sin again, find the way out that he's provided, get out of there, confess it and say, God, forgive me. And God is saying, I'm waiting, longing to remind you of the greatness of my forgiveness and my grace. That's the heart of it. He is faithful to forgive us. I remember talking with a woman in my family, and Sherry and I had shared the message of Jesus with her many, many times through the years. And when she was finally at a point where she was starting to be open, she was actually attending a church, she was actually singing in a church choir, but she hadn't yet given her heart to Jesus. She hadn't yet confessed her sins to Jesus. And I asked her why. And here's the first thing she said. She said, I know that Jesus forgives anyone who confesses their sins. She'd been in church long enough. She didn't grow up in church, but she'd heard that enough and read it in the Bible. She knew that was true. Here's what she said. I'm just afraid I'll be the first person that Jesus says no to. That was a lie from the pit of hell. That's what that was. But that was her fear. And we talked about the fact that he's faithful and just. He's ready to forgive. Remember that faithfulness. And if you're wandering in sin, come back to the cross. Come back to Jesus again and again. Confess your sin and be reminded that his grace is always enough. Lessons of faithfulness. Here's a fourth lesson. God is a faithful, good shepherd. Our God is a faithful, good shepherd who cares about us, who loves us, who longs to show us his grace and his forgiveness. And this 23rd Psalm, maybe the best known Psalm in all of the Bible, shows this picture of the faithfulness of God. I want to read this to you, and I want you just to kind of quiet your heart. And maybe for some of you, you've never heard the 23rd Psalm. Maybe for some of you, you've heard it 1,000 times. But I pray you'll listen to it like you're hearing it for the first time and listen to what God is faithful to do in this beautiful psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God's faithfulness provides for us. God's faithfulness leads us in the tough times. God's faithfulness protects us. God's faithfulness lavishes his goodness on us. God's faithfulness is personal. He is the good shepherd, and we are his sheep. And God's faithfulness is eternal. It is eternal, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. If we are going to see the fruit of faithfulness blossom in our lives, please hear this. It begins right here with God's faithfulness. Remember his faithfulness to forgive, his faithfulness to love, to fill, to guide, that he is the good shepherd. And if we're going to walk in faithfulness, it starts by us looking and seeing the faithfulness of our God. But then we get this privilege of partnering with God and saying, Lord, how can I walk in faithfulness? How can I enter this into this place of partnering with God in growing the fruit of faithfulness in my life? In this crazy world that doesn't even talk about faithfulness, it's almost not even part of our vocabulary anymore. How do I grow in faithfulness? Well, let's look at our side of the equation, how we partner with God. How do we live with intentional faithfulness? Live with intentional faithfulness. Say that with me. You ready? Live with intentional faithfulness. One more time. Live with intentional faithfulness, because we choose to be faithful. Because the current of our culture is not pushing us naturally towards faithfulness. There's a whole lot of things moving us towards unfaithfulness. But we can be intentional in our faithfulness. So here's the first thing. If we want to live in intentional faithfulness, by identifying, naming, and casting out idols. We have to identify and name. Say, this is an idol in my life. And then I cast it out. You say, well, what's an idol in my life? Now watch closely. Here's an idol. This is God ruling supreme over our lives, our hearts, our minds, our time, our schedule, our finances. Here's God who's the Lord of all in our lives. When anything or anyone takes a place above God, that's an idol. And when something takes a place above God, God is generally not second in our lives. He just starts dropping down the list really quickly. Either God is Lord of all, or man, he tends to fall off the radar of our lives. And can I tell you that an hour and 10 minutes a week, once or twice a month, and not thinking about God or walking alongside him in any other way during the week, I got a pretty good feeling if that's where we're at, then God is not Lord of our lives the way he needs to be. And other things have taken. So what can take that place? It can be hobbies. It can be a hobby. I've watched people get possessed with a hobby. It can be entertainment and media. I give God an hour a week, and I give media 30 hours a week. Then what's ruling my life? What's consuming my heart and my thoughts? It can be a person who means so much to us that they take the place above God. It can be my job. It can be finances. It can be almost anything. And Satan wants anything at all to be over God. And God says, I want to be over all in your life. And so if you want to walk in faithfulness, here's the key. Identify. So here's God who should rule and reign in our hearts and our lives. Not just with our words, but in our time and all that we do. Here's God who rules and reigns. Here's my question for you. What is it that right now has taken this place above God in your life, or If God is here, what is it that's always like trying to go, creep up into, what is it in your life that's always trying to take that place and push God down? Is it fear and anxiety? Is it a person? Is it a hobby? Is it money? What is it that's always trying to find its way there? Only you can identify that. But when you identify it, and I hope right now you'll just say, Lord, I know what that is in my life, or I know what it is that's always trying to creep up and take over and be first in my life and first in my heart and first in my mind. When you identify that, you say, I will cast it down. I will throw it down. I will not let that rule my life. If you want to be encouraged in learning how to cast down idols, and your note taker, write this down, 2 Kings 22 and 23. You read 2 Kings 22 and 23 in the next day or two, and you meditate on this young man, Josiah. Josiah became king when he was 8 years old. He took kind of leadership between 16 and 18. They would give him the role of leadership. At 26 years old, this is all found in 2 Kings 22 and 23. When he's 26 years old, still a pretty young guy, at 26 years old, he says, listen, the temple of God is in ruins. Idolatry was, and these were actually idols people were worshiping above God. So he says, clean it out. And let's fix the temple back up so we can put God first where he belongs. And while they're cleaning up the temple, they find the book of the law, probably the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, the first five books of the Old Testament. But they find the book of the law and they bring it to Josiah, this young king, and he says, read it to me. So they begin to read the words of the law to him, and he begins to mourn and weep because here's what he realizes. All these other idols have taken place above God, and it breaks the heart of God, and it's not how we should live our lives. And then Josiah does something profoundly powerful. If you're a note taker, write this down. He goes ballistic on idols. Write it down. He goes ballistic. He says, every idol is fallen. And you read those chapters and you will be blown away. He doesn't just like take the idols and throw them down. He crushes them to dust and he throws them in the river and he burns them. I mean, he goes ballistic. He says, the idols are gonna fall. And that's what we need to do in our lives. If you look at your life and say, boy, here's God in my life, but this has taken over. And it's time to cast it down. So I don't know, what do you mean by this? I don't know what it is in your life. I know what it is in my life that's always trying to creep up and take over the place of God. I know what it is in my life. And I know what it takes to throw those things down. And they always try to creep back up again. I gotta fight them down again. But you read Josiah's story and you watch how intense he was. And you say, God, make me like that when it comes to the things in my life that are taking precedence over you, that are consuming my heart and my mind and my soul and my energy and are taking over in my life. Because unless we're willing to be serious about it, then it's just gonna stay the same. And God will keep falling down the list of important things in our life instead of being the Lord he's meant to be. And so you say, okay, well, some people say, well, I don't even know what you're talking about. Here's just a couple examples. So say maybe you look at your life and you go, okay, here's God, but what's taken over for me is technology and media and all these things where God gets an hour and 10 minutes of my life maybe once or twice a month. But man, I'm putting 4 or 5, 6 hours every day into. I mean, I can't go 10 minutes without checking my. I mean, in church for an hour, I can't not check my social media. I can't find out who likes me, who doesn't like me, what's going on. I can't. You know, that consumes me. And that's. I mean, that's. I think about God once or twice a week, but I think about me and my, presentation of myself, my social media about 40 times a day or 100 times a day. Or say, okay, if that's the case, cast it down. So how do I do that? How about this? Do a 7-day social media fast. Don't look at Facebook, don't look at Twitter, don't look at Instagram, don't look at anything. People say, well, but then people won't, I mean, then my life, I can't, blah, I can't, why? It's a week? Well, try a day. I think it'd be great once a year to do a 30-day fast from all that stuff and purge your system of it and find out and make some, boy, if that thing's become, if social media is the thing that's above God, you know who's above God? It's you. Because social media is primarily about us. Cast yourself down and put God where he belongs, your life will change. But I don't know what it is for you or how you cast it down, but I know if you follow Josiah's example, you go ballistic on it, you'll find a way to tear it down. You have an unhealthy relationship. Here's God, God should be ruling your life, but this person has become so important to you and they're not honoring life to God, and they're not encouraging you, but they've just taken this place above God. Now your faith is waning because your life's all about this person. If some of you are dating or some of you are hanging out with, it's like, well, how do I cast that down? Figure it out. It may be saying, I got to end this relationship. It may be saying, I got to pull back time from that person. I got to get God back where he belongs. A lot of people are like, I don't want to do that. This is serious business. When idols creep up in our lives, we cast them. If stuff is an idol, if material, the accumulation of material things is what your life is all about. So God should be here, but man, the accumulation and care of stuff is here. Cast it down. How do I do that? I don't know exactly for you. Here's a thought. Start giving stuff away. You know, you want to put a stake in the heart of materialism? Give some stuff away. What do I give away? I don't know. What do you love most? You want to kill it fast? You want to drive a stake in its heart? I don't know what it is for you. But I know this. If you want to walk in faithfulness to God, and you see something taking this place above God, it's time to cast it, to name it, to cast it down. And if you're like Josiah, you'll throw it down, you'll crush it into dust, you'll burn it with fire, you'll throw it in the river, and you'll spit on it, done with you. And it'll come to life and try to creep up again, and you fight it again. This is the journey of faithfulness. It's not easy. And so, God, we pray, whatever the idol is in our life, whatever that thing is or those things are that have taken over and taken charge of our lives, Lord, give us the strength and the wisdom to see them, to name them, and show us what our step is to cast them down and to put you on the throne of all we are and all we do. How do we live with intentional faithfulness? By deciding to follow and serve God even when life seems unfair. Do you know a lot of followers of Jesus, when life gets tough and seems unfair, they go, I don't know if I can follow Jesus anymore. I'll say to them, why? Well, this hard thing happened. This thing that was unfair happened. Can I tell you a little secret? If you're going to choose to not follow Jesus because tough things hit your life, things that are unfair hit your life, you won't follow Jesus for very long. Because hard things hit our lives and there is deep pain and sorrow and loss in life. And if you're at a point right now where you're saying, I'm not really faithfully following Jesus. I'm here at church, but I'm not faithfully following Jesus because some hard, unfair things have happened and I just question if God's even real or if he even loves me because of hard things. You want to be encouraged with a new perspective. Read the book of Ruth. Write that down. Read the book of Ruth. Ruth has this amazing story of this woman named Naomi. Her and her husband, Elimelech, are married, and they live in Bethlehem in the ancient world, and there's a famine. There's no food. You want to talk about unfair? Famine hits your land, and you have no food. You're starving to death. That's not fair. They pack up, and they move with their two sons to an area called Moab. And while they're there, Naomi's husband dies. That's not fair. Her husband dies. But her two sons get married. They meet these nice Moabite girls, one of them by the name of Ruth, who's the book is named after, Ruth. And they get married, but 10 years later, we don't know the details, but her two sons die. Now she's in a foreign land. Her husband has died. Her two sons have died. In the ancient world, she has no safety net. There's no social security. There's nothing to, she's desolate. So she's going to basically go back to Bethlehem, try to find a way to make ends meet and live out her life. You want to talk about unfair. The beautiful thing about Ruth is when this young Moabite woman who had married Naomi's son and then her husband had died, she says to Naomi, Naomi says, just stay here with your people. I don't have anything to give you. I don't have anything to offer you. But what Naomi offered her was a faithful life. Naomi loved God, even when she lost her husband and her sons. And so Ruth says, no, where you go, I will go. And where you stay, I will stay. And only death will divide us. And your God will be my God. Ruth watched this woman lose everything that was dear to her, but she held what was the most dear, and that was her faith in God. And Ruth said, I'll follow you anywhere you go. Be faithful to God even when life gets unfair, because life will get unfair. You want to be faithful? Be faithful even in the hard times. How do we live with intentional faithfulness? We do it even when the world affirms unfaithfulness as normative. And our world affirms unfaithfulness as the norm. You want to be faithful to God, you stay faithful even when the world says faithfulness doesn't matter. And I want to lean specifically right now into one specific area, and that is the beauty of romantic relationships that God has established and given. When God brings a man and a woman together, and their hearts begin to be joined together. They begin to fall in love. I'm not talking about dating 20 people. I'm talking about when God brings the right man, the right woman, he begins to bring them together. Faithfulness honors God. And that faithfulness isn't just to each other. That faithfulness is to God and to each other, because that's the partnership. God is faithful. We grow in faithfulness. But we live in a culture that says, be unfaithful. It's no big deal. As a matter of fact, you know what the normative model and image is in movies and TV shows, and I think in reality for many people, if a couple's about to get married, and God's brought this man and woman together, and they're about to get married, but right before they get married, the best man throws a party for the groom and hires strippers and prostitutes and takes, and this is the model that's being presented to people. And so that guy who's about to be imprisoned by this marriage very soon can have one more time to be unfaithful and kind of have a great party. Really? That's the way to right before you say, I'm going to be faithful to you for the rest of my life, I'm going to be unfaithful one more time? Really? And now the image in the movies and TV shows is for the women, you know what the image is now? Same deal. One more time to have a little fun before you get imprisoned by marriage. But you know what? Being unfaithful before you get married doesn't help you become faithful when you get married. You know what the training ground was for my wife and I to be faithful? I've been faithful to my wife for 35 years now. She's been faithful to me for 35 years. Since we've been married, we've not been intimate with anybody but each other. You know how we learned to get ready for that? When I met her, crazy about her, we dated for 2 years. You know what we didn't do? We didn't thumb our nose at God for 2 years and say, you know what, we're gonna sleep with each other, we're gonna have sex, we're gonna do whatever we want. And then the day we get married, we'll be faithful to each other. We'll be unfaithful to you, God, for 2 years and practice, we'll get trained and equipped to be unfaithful and to justify our sin and to reject what you want, God, and we're gonna sleep together. And then when we get married, we'll be wonderfully faithful to each other. You wanna get prepared to be unfaithful in your marriage? Be unfaithful to God before you're married. You wanna know why we've been able to, and it hasn't been that tough for 35 years. Because for 2 years before we were married, I said no to her about 1,000 times. I had to run away from her sometimes. And she's fast. She's a distance runner. I'm being serious. Well, not that part about her change. Well, sometimes. But that's a whole other seminar. Here's the reality. What makes us think that rejecting God's plan for intimacy and sexuality and saying, I'm going to be involved in this before I get married. Once I get married, then I'll be totally faithful to this person. When all I've done is prepared to be unfaithful for my entire relationship before that. And I know in our world right now, you're old-fashioned. Well, the Bible's old-fashioned. It's been around a long time. But God made us, and he knows how we work best. And can I challenge you toward faithfulness in your marriage relationship? And if you're married and you've been unfaithful, repent and stop now and turn your heart back to your spouse. If that's being enticed out there and being lured to something, don't walk down that road. But say, God, you are faithful to me, and I want to be faithful to you. And I'll tell you right now, at Shoreline Church, we have Greg, who's now become our leader of our children's ministry, so we could actually take Pastor Roy Pena and have Roy oversee marriage and family life. And Roy puts all of his time into marriage and family life, and he oversees our youth and our children, but he puts his time into marriage and family life. If you want to strengthen your marriage, we got more and more happening in our church for that. And actually, Pastor Roy's out in the courtyard today at a booth there. And if you're married or thinking about getting married, go by there and say, what's going on for marriages? And we're going to keep doing more and more to strengthen marriages, because there's a full-on, all-out assault on faithfulness in marriage. Faithfulness is not even on the radar of conversation in our culture these days, and it needs to be. It needs to be. How do we live with intentional faithfulness? The fourth thing. We live with intentional faithfulness even when the road is long, hot, and seems endless. There's times where we're trying to be faithful and we're trying to do the right thing, and the road just seems so long. And if you want to get encouraged there, read Moses' story in the book of Exodus. You know, Moses is going to lead God's people. God's got this great plan for his life, but he also ends up in the desert for, now get this, 40 years. In a waiting time, preparing to do the great work God had for him. What were you doing 40 years ago? Some of you are like, I wasn't doing anything. I wasn't. 40 years is a long time. Moses waited for 40 years until God unleashed him into the destiny he had for him. And some of you are being faithful to God, but you're getting weary and tired because the road has been long and dusty and hard and hot. And you're like, I don't know if I can keep being faithful to God. Stay faithful. Maybe it's another month till God has that breakthrough. Maybe it's another 40 years. But faithfulness is always honoring to God. The God we gather to worship here today is so radically faithful. Jesus revealed it as he washed the disciples' feet, so undeserving, and yet he came and was faithful to them. And God is our good shepherd, and God provides, and God protects. And God says, now I invite you to walk in faithfulness. We don't have strength to do it on our own, but he who is in us is greater than the one who's in the world. And when we come to Christ and receive him, and when his faithfulness fills us, we can walk in faithfulness, and it honors God. Oh God, we pray in this radically crazy world that celebrates unfaithfulness, that creates environments that invite unfaithfulness. Will you teach us to be more like Jesus? May the fruit of faithfulness grow in us as we look to you, our faithful God, as we hold your hand and as you lead us into a faithful future. And Lord, where there's idols, we pray that we will see them and name them and cast them down. And we will strive for faithfulness no matter what the world says. Lord, I pray that this fruit of faithfulness will transform friendships and engagements and marriages and homes and families and employers and employees and Christians all around this community as we live more faithfully for you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.